Good morning all. Today we are going to discuss about the double field revolving theory for the analysis of single phase supply given to an induction motor. So let us take the same thing like we have taken in the last class. I have taken the conductors in the stator. So let us assume I have applied my single phase supply. Let us assume supply voltage is applied. Now the current will pass through the stator. Because of this, the current will start passing like this, the dots in the upper part and cross in the lower part. If you apply your right hand thumb rule, then you will get your direction of your main field flux will be like this. This is the axis of your field. This is your stator axis. So with respect to this axis, as I move on, the MMF will goes on decreasing. The MMF will become zero here and the MMF will go on decaying like this. So otherwise we can tell that if you write the MMF here, it will be maximum. It will go on decaying with respect to theta and it will go on moving like this. This is with respect to theta. This is the value of MMF. How the MMF will be there or how the flux distribution will be there in the field. Now, with respect to the time, because we know our supply is sinusoidal supply. So, with respect to the time, our sinusoidal supply varies like this. This is my current IS. Because of this, the value of IS, the flux that is produced, magnitude of the flux with respect to time. So, it will vary sinusoidally. So, as a summary of this or as a combination of this, I can write the equation for the alternating magnetic field or the magnetic field that is produced. That magnetic field I can write as the phi is equal to the value of B maximum into A, or I can tell that the phi maximum into sin omega t into cos alpha, where alpha is the angle with respect to that, or either we can write theta or we can write it as alpha, whatever the angle you take. So this is the form of your flux, resultant flux wave with respect to any point in the space. So if you are taking at this point it will vary sinusoidally only. As the alpha is changing, what is the value? You have to multiply with cos of the alpha. That gives the magnitude of any other point with respect to the space. So now this can be resolved into two components. So this can be written as this. We know that sin A plus B plus sin A minus B will be equal to 2 sin A cos B. So we are going to use that relationship. So this I can write as sin A plus B plus sin A minus B. This I can write as 2 sin A cos B. So let us try to correlate this. I can write A is equal to omega t and B is equal to alpha. Then I am getting this equation. Only difference is coming. This 2 is not there. So I have to divide my result with 2. So this I can write as phi maximum by 2. So this I can write as sin of omega t plus alpha plus phi maximum by 2 sin of omega t minus alpha. I can write as the combination of two waves. So you can see here your original flux wave, I can write in the combination of two waves. One wave is coming as omega t plus alpha. Second wave is coming as omega t minus alpha. So this is the equation of nothing but the rotating magnetic field having a magnitude of equal to phi by 2. You can refer to the three phase rotating magnetic field. We have got the equation in the similar way, where in this case this omega t minus phi, this omega t minus phi, so this will be rotating in the forward direction. So this component will be rotating in the forward direction. This is called as the forward rotating magnetic field. And this one omega t minus alpha. So at every value of omega t to compensate, I have to take as minus alpha. That means the maximum value will go on decreasing in this direction. So this is called as the backward rotating magnetic field. That means whatever is your flux, that flux can be represented as the sum of two rotating magnetic fields, each having half the magnitude of the original flux wave. And one is rotating in the forward direction, another one is rotating in the backward direction. So two rotating magnetic fields are there. Now we can take this as sum of two induction motors, three phase induction motors. One is having the forward rotating magnetic field and second one is coming as the backward rotating magnetic field. So let us try to analyze this. So let us assume I am just taking this instant. This is my forward rotating magnetic field. This is phi f and this is phi b. Or otherwise I can write as forward rotating magnetic field. So this forward rotating magnetic field, I am taking the backward rotating magnetic field. This forward rotating magnetic field rotates in the forward direction at the speed of ns, and backward rotating magnetic field will rotate in opposite direction at a speed of ns in opposite direction. So whenever this flux is there, rotating magnetic field is there, this is interacting with your rotor. So automatically EMF will be induced in your rotor, which I can write as E2 because of the forward field, E2 because of the backward field. So now because of this, the currents will produce in the rotor. This will be I2F in the forward and I2B in the backward. The currents are induced. So because of the currents in the rotor, they produce the flux. One is phi2F and in the backward direction it will be phi2B. So now what this happens, these two fluxes are in opposite direction. So, and this flux will always try to oppose the cause. What is the cause? Cause is the main field flux. What is the main field flux? Phi F is the flux responsible for production of phi2F and phi B is responsible for production of phi2B. So automatically I can tell my resultant forward flux will be equal to phi F minus phi2F. Similarly, the resultant backward flux in the air gap will be equal to phi B minus phi2B. So this produces the forward torque and this produces the backward torque. So forward torque will produce the torque in the forward direction. Backward torque will produce the torque in the backward direction. So we know that as these two magnitude of both phi2F and phi2B are equal and phi F and phi B are equal, automatically if TF will be equal to TB, so your resultant flux, which is the difference of TF and TB, so this will be equal to 0. So as a resultant of this, the net torque produced will be equal to 0. So this is the way we can analyze that the net torque will be equal to 0. There is another way of analysis of this. The another way of analysis is just analyzing in the form of an induction motor. In the induction motor, we have seen that the torque produced will be like this. We have seen this. If you extend this, this will go up to here. So let us assume this is at 2. So this is with respect to the speed, or with respect to the speed, this is at slip is equal to 0. These are slip is equal to 1. This is slip is equal to 2. This is slip. So this is for the case of the forward rotating field, because due to forward rotating field, this is the torque that will be produced. Similarly, backward rotating field will rotate in the backward direction. So the torque will be like this. That means it will start from here. So it will go on changing like this. And it will come at this is equal to 2. So this is due to the backward rotating field. This is torque because of the backward field. So if your resultant field, if you want to calculate, resultant field will be the sum of these two fields. If you observe that at the standstill condition, this one will be equal to this one. So your net torque will be equal to 0. The forward torque will be equal to reverse torque. But if you take the sum at any other speeds, then you will observe that you can get your torque will be coming like this. So this will follow this nearly. This will be the case. And in the backward direction, it will come like this. This is your the resultant torque. So from this equation, from this curve, you can tell that at speed n is equal to 0, the resultant torque is equal to 0. But using some mechanism, if you can push it in any one direction, so your net torque will not be equal to 0. So motor will start accelerating in that particular direction and it will reach the required speed. So from this curve, we can tell. Let us try to analyze in another way. So let us assume I have given my rotation in the forward direction. That means in the direction of forward rotating field. Then in that case, the relative speed between the stator and rotor, because of that the EMF will be induced. So let us try to calculate slip in the forward direction. That means let us assume this is my rotor. Your rotor is given the initial rotation in the forward direction. Let us assume it is rotating at a speed n. So this is my forward rotating field and this is my backward rotating field. So from this I can calculate the slip in the forward field will be nothing but the slip of a normal induction motor. This is nothing but ns minus n divided by ns. If you are taking an RPS, we write the small letters. We write the capital letters when you are taking an RPM. Just remember this, both are one and the same. 1 minus n divided by ns. Similarly, for the backward field, if you take the backward field, the speed of rotation is be ns. And the direction of the rotor with respect to this rotor backward field is both are rotating in opposite direction. So the relative speed will be adding to each other, or we have to take the original speed of the rotor as minus n. So I can take ns minus of minus n divided by ns. This becomes ns plus n divided by ns, or this becomes 1 plus n divided by ns. Okay, this is what we get. So SB is equal to 1 plus n divided by ns. So let us try to equate this equation. Let us take this as equation number 1. Let us take this as equation number 2. Let us try to add equation number 1 and 2. I can write that SF plus SB, or simply S plus SB, this will be equal to 1 minus n divided by ns plus 1 plus n divided by ns. So n divided by ns, n divided by ns will cancel. So this will become 2. Or from this I can write my backward slip corresponding to the backward rotating field, SB will be equal to 2 minus S. So slip for the backward field is 2 minus S times of the forward field. The slip is more in the case of backward direction. Or this equivalent circuit diagram for this, because I told that this can be represented as a sum of two induction motors. So one induction motor will have X2 and R2 by S. This is for the case of forward field. I2F will pass and EF is applied to this. And the second case, the EF will be induced in the rotor and the rotor equivalent will be X2 and this will be R2 by 2 minus S. So because of this, I2B will be passing through this. This is the value of EB. Because of EB, I2B will be induced. So we can take the sum of these two. So let us try to analyze when you are given the initial twist, how to analyze this using from the torque equations point of view. So I am taking phi F, I am taking phi B. So this phi F is rotating in the forward direction at a speed ns, phi B is rotating in reverse direction at a speed of ns. So because of this, the EMF will be induced, because now it is not stationary. So it will not be simple E2, it will be SF times of E2F, because S times of E will be induced. This we already know. This will be SB times of E2B. Okay, because we know that SB is equal to 2 minus S, and this value of 2 minus S will be far, far greater than the S, or is far, far greater than SF, or we can tell that SP is far, far greater than SF, because it is 2 minus S, the slip will be very less generally. So that's why we can tell that the current induced or the EMF because of the backward, this will be far, far greater than that of the forward. So automatically, because of this, I2F is induced, because of I2B is induced. So automatically I2B is greater than I2F. So because of this, the flux is produced by the rotor. This is phi2B, this is phi2F. Again, this phi2B is greater than phi2F. So because of this, the resultant field, resultant forward field, which is the difference of phi F minus phi 2F, and here phi 2 backward field will be equal to phi B minus phi 2B. So this phi resultant value, because phi 2F is less, phi F and phi B are equal magnitude. So automatically the resultant forward flux is more. So the torque is produced because of the resultant flux. So the resultant forward flux will be greater than this one. So automatically the torque of the forward direction will be greater than that of the backward direction. We know both torques are in opposite direction. So resultant torque is the difference of TF and TB. So TF is greater than TB. So automatically this will be in the direction of T forward direction, or we can take it as a positive direction. So we can conclude that whichever direction you give the initial rotation, the rotor will start rotating in that direction. The rotor will start rotating in that direction. But only limitation of this case is when you are giving the initial twist, the torque will not be constant, because torque is depending on sin omega t. So it will continuously vary with respect to the time. The torque will not be constant. If you draw the torque curve, the torque will come like this. So torque is not continuous. That is the only limitation of single phase induction motor. So next class, we are going to see how to produce the constant torque and how to make the motor self-starting. That means when the motor is standstill also, how the torque can be produced. So that we are going to see in the tomorrow's class, and then we will follow up for the remaining topics of single phase induction motors. I hope all these topics are clear to you. If you still have queries, you can leave your comments in the comment section below. I will answer to your queries from there. Thank you. Thank you very much.